take videos and post them up. And you guys can use the hashtag OpenCurtain to go ahead and submit your questions, which we will go ahead and answer.
And this is the curtain open now. Now that's the view that you normally don't get to see. Not because they want to hide on stage, but because usually that's where the magic happens during an intermission.
So Nathan, we have a few questions for you already, and one of them is with regard to this particular, the portal we've got here, this panel.
Yeah.
What significance is the panel in terms of the production and its
The panel is setting the room, so with the panel, we're either in the hunting room, as we've just had Daniel's amazing sit-in, or we had, now there's a chainmail coming on for the next. This is basically setting the scene. Since we're not changing much else of the set, Michael Hirgen, the set designer, has decided to use a large tracking beam that is using a pump hoist and two system pipes to track the panel back and forth, and to use dancers or stagehands or singers to turn the panel around, and there's lock pins for the positions.
So this is a very interesting set. We don't usually see a curved back wall like this. Can you tell us a little bit about what kind of benefits that this gives to the singer?
I tell you, the singers love this set because for the singers, it's basically like an acoustic reflector. It's a shell, and the music does not get lost in the vastness of the stage, but it actually is being projected. And for the singers in the chorus, it is very good to hear themselves, to interact, to stay on tune, but also they get a great feedback from the orchestra. So this is an acoustically perfect set.
That's great. We have one of our questions from Twitter just came in from Melinda McLean, who asks, what time period did Francesca Zambella, the director of the production, have in mind when she was setting this piece?
If I only knew. That's one of those questions that I forgot to ask Francesca when she was here. I wasn't here when the production was originally created in the early 2000s. But it was ahead of its time when Michael Jürgen designed the set. I think it is a Japanese landscape. That's basically what we're seeing, which is sort of timeless. On the other hand, all the costumes we're seeing are 18th century, 19th century costumes. It's quite stylized at times. And for those of you who have seen the production when it's originally premiered on our stage here 15 years ago, the costumes of the principals looked quite different. We have different principals now, with different singers now, and the singers didn't fit those costumes, or Francesca and Laurie Feldman, the revival director, didn't think that those costumes would still fit the piece. So our costume shop actually did the magic together with our costume supervisors and changed the costumes. You probably might have seen all the lackey costumes with our four stagehands that came on stage in costume to help Katya down from the horse. We try to hide them because in black they don't look that good. In black they blend in very well with everything that's happening backstage. But we give them a costume so that for stagehands as well as props personnel to come and join the action and change over sets or place furniture or move someone in with a horse. It's a wonderful ceremonial event and take her off the horse.
So I was actually really curious about the horse myself. What is the horse actually made of? Is it actually metal and big and heavy?
Everything in theater is fake. And that's phenomenal because no one notices. So it is made of polystyrene, and it is covered with plaster or fiberglass, and it's built on a wooden block, actually, that has casters underneath, and there's an air pressure compressor inside, so a tank, that lifts the horse up, and you might have seen someone manipulating in the back of the horse. That's what the horse lowered and secured in its position.
And it's obviously strong enough to support a full-grown person, so.
Yeah, you should see what our stagehand do on this when it's not on stage. You know, I mean, they go wild with the horse. It's sort of a rodeo scene at times back there. I mean, you know, with the 70 people that are involved backstage currently.
Oh, yeah?
It's just amazing. Every time you come to the theater, this is not a big production in terms of the set changes and scene changes. And as you can see now, our carpenters are currently putting on the next panels for the chainmail. This is all painted wood, though it is pretty big and pretty large and is put on the frame. And it requires a lot of skill to be put on, and that's why we're very fortunate to have a collaboration, and that's for 93 years with our local 16 stagehands.
So those are just painted rings, they're not actually any sort of actual chainmail, is it?
Let me check, but as I said, everything in this theater is fake except for this guy. Yes, it is wood, and we have had to order a few hundred because over time we store our scenery in containers, and the containers, as you might know from experience, get warm, get cold, it's warm, it's cold, it's damp, it's dry, and over time the hot glue with which they are attached and little nails came off. So when we unload it, what is this, the boar? We had to do a few, no animals got hurt during the production. So we have to say, while on stage no animals get hurt, we're quite careful. But where did this come from?
So we just had another question come in from Twitter, and it was about the flooring. They're noticing that it's actually angled.
Yeah.
So what is this called? Is this a theater trick, or?
We are on a rake, and a rake just gives you a better perspective of when people move back and forth. It is also quite helpful to have this elevation in terms of sight lines, but it's not that helpful for everyone performing on a rake, because as you notice, you're always slightly leaning forward, and it does require practice. At times when we have to have things level, especially off stage that are built for a rake, we have to put counter rakes underneath in order to make it level. Our props crew and people are currently props crew setting the scene. It's just wonderful. We're having a parade of animals. You've just seen the silhouette of them before, and now they're being put in storage, ready for the last performance of Luisa Miller on Sunday. It's already, it's already the last performance. We just opened that up.
So we had another question come in from Twitter, and they were asking, you spoke about the differences in costumes between the 2000 production and now. Is there anything else of note that would have been different between the 2000 performance and now?
Some of the choristers. No, I mean, really, the cast is different, and the artistic personnel is different. It's quite fascinating that a production that was created 15 years ago it has still valid for the stage today and has still this message. It's a beautiful music, isn't it? I mean, it's a piece that probably we should all listen to more often. But I was taken away by it when I was sat at the tech table when we were taking the production during the summer.
And if anybody, again, reminder, if anybody has questions and would like to submit them, go ahead, pull out your phone and tweet them with the hashtag OpenCurtain. Also, feel free to take photos, take videos, and go ahead and share that on your social media pages as well. And appreciate that. So, David, do you have anything else you want to speak about this production?
Yeah, I mean, there's a big open hole in front of me, not the prompt box. You see from this side only the prompt box, but there's a big open hole where the band sits, where the music comes from, where the orchestra is. Maestro Luisotti, our music director, is leading the orchestra tonight, and it's just marvelous. It's one of those moments that I get chills just now thinking of it. But it's 65 musicians in the pit, and we have backstage banda musicians, another three. In the chorus, we've got 56 people, and we have 8 supers on stage. What does that mean? You can be a super in one of our productions if you would like to be on stage with all the stars that are performing at San Francisco Opera. But you can be a part of that, and all you have to do is send an email to supers@sfopera.com and you might be on that stage pretty soon.
We did have another question come in. David, can you speak at all to the longevity of a chorister at the San Francisco Opera? How long will they serve for the, and would they be able to sing for the opera chorus?
That's one of the big qualities of San Francisco Opera. I've joined the organization in February of this year, so I'm the new kid in town. But a lot of the choristers have been here for years and years and years, and our institutional resource and musical guidance for new choristers who join. I mean, you know, being a chorister and being in those costumes, yes, it does look prestigious if you're in the auditorium, it just looks grand. But wearing one of these on stage with the lights on, whew, it feels like a sauna at times.
Very true. Well, anything else you want to add?
A big thank you to you guys for coming.
Yes.
We've got two more Sweeney Todd performances coming up. One tomorrow and one on Tuesday. That's the last one of this run. And who of you has seen Sweeney Todd already?
Excellent.
So that means for everyone else who's not clapping, come back tomorrow or come back on Tuesday. And if you like this show very much, then come back Sunday for the last performance of Luisa Miller. But before that, there's actually more after the intermission. Thank you very much. Come back and we'll see you shortly.
Thank you all.
Have a good night.